Wow. So wow. It's been, what, a week since the last episode, and so much has gone down. Russia has invaded Ukraine, the original Ghostbusters director tragically passed away, 2022 Kenobi series leaks. It's gonna be a good episode. If you're new here, my name is Isaac, and yeah, let's do this. So, let's briefly go back to last episode. At the time of the recording, it was the 11th of February, and the next day, tragically, Ivan Reitman passed away. The original Ghostbusters director and father of the director of Ghostbusters Afterlife. He had such a spectacular life, and I look up to him deeply. If you don't already know, my dream in life and passion is to be a filmmaker and film and TV director. I loved the original Ghostbusters movies, and if I love a movie, I already love the director. I'm just so heartbroken that we have again lost another legend. Too many in the last few years. At least he was here to see his son's film, Ghostbusters Afterlife. And Ivan said it was a very personal and sometimes tear-inducting experience. The day that all three of them showed up for the first time and were just checking stuff out. It was just extraordinary. Just feeling the vibe, not just for me, but I felt it in the crew and cast. I felt it everywhere. That is what he said after he saw Ghostbusters Afterlife and when he was on set of Ghostbusters Afterlife. So he did enjoy Ghostbusters Afterlife and enjoyed watching his son make it. Now, ladies and gentlemen, Ukraine are currently doing their absolute best, trying to hold on as Russia has invaded them. On the 24th of February, 2022, Russia officially invaded Ukraine. Vladimir Putin has declared war on Ukraine, and there are reports of Russia attacking several locations across the country. Vladimir Putin launched a broad Russian military offense targeting Ukraine at about 5 a.m. local time, about 3 a.m. GMT, on Thursday morning, the 24th of February, 2022, after broadcasting a speech announcing a special military operation to demilitarize Ukraine. According to Ukraine officials, the initial wave of strikes appeared to involve cruise missiles, weaponry, and airstrikes, which struck military transportation and border positions, including air bases. 3 hours into the attack, the Russian Defense Ministry was claiming to have counterbalanced Ukraine's air bases and air defenses. Although most of the airstrikes were concentrated to the east, strikes were also reported in the west of Ukraine. Ukraine officials with the Border Guard Service and elsewhere were also reporting an armoured attack from Belarus through the Senkivka border, crossing in the north of the country, backed by Belarusian troops. There were also reports of Russian troops crossing the border to the east of Kharkiv and Russian defence moving into Ukraine from Crimea, suggesting a three-pronged attack from north, south, and east at around 7 a.m. local time, which is 5 a.m. GMT. 2 hours into the assault, Russia-backed nationalist rebels were reported to be attacking Ukraine positions around the self-proclaimed republics in Luhansk and Donetsk. The full scope of the Russian military operation was not immediately clear, but Putin said, "Our plans do not include the pursuit of Ukraine territories. We are not going to impose anything by force." Putin and Russian officials have also repeatedly denied planning a military assault on Ukraine. In the immediate aftermath of the first wave of strikes, Ukraine's president announced martial law had been declared across the country. The president of Ukraine has called on all citizens who are ready to defend the country from Russia forces to come forward. Like, what's going on at the moment? It's actually very scary. And I'm very lucky to be in Australia. But will I always be lucky to be living in Australia? Who knows? Who knows what's going to happen with Putin wanting to take over the world. Same as China and North Korea. And who knows if one day our allies, the USA, will turn their backs on us. I don't believe they will. But you don't know what people will do. Well, it's becoming corrupt. Start a World War III, maybe, maybe not. Who knows? But I just want peace, you know. Honestly, I have no idea why Putin wants to do this to Ukraine, except for that Ukraine used to be the Soviet Union's land, and he wants it back, but still, that doesn't give you the right to endanger innocent lives. I don't want to say anything else. I don't want to somehow get myself in trouble, but, you know, it is sad. Yes, yes, yes. You know what that means. We are back talking about Star Wars, but this time, the Kenobi series. One of the many upcoming Star Wars series, but it's probably the most anticipated. The series brings Ewan McGregor back to a galaxy far, far away to fill in crucial gaps in Obi-Wan's timeline. The years between Revenge of the Sith and A New Hope. So it will be about 10 years after Revenge of the Sith and about 9-ish years before A New Hope. Now, I am so excited for the Kenobi series, airing on Disney Plus on May the 25th, 2022. I really hope we don't get disappointed with it like we did with some aspects of the Book of Boba Fett. Also, May the 5th is before Kenobi comes out, and surely Lucasfilm and Disney will give us something on that date. But I hope it's not the Kenobi trailer, and I say that because I don't want the trailer 20 days beforehand. I hope it comes out earlier. So we may get a Mando Season 3 trailer or an Andor trailer, or we might get the Kenobi series on that day, who knows. But it would be sick to see a Mando Season 3 trailer or an Andor trailer. I don't think we'll get the Ahsoka series trailer just yet, because they don't start filming for that till next month, I believe. But who knows. Okay, so we know Yoda gave Obi-Wan his final lesson on how to communicate with his former master, and we've even witnessed it in Claudia Gray's short story, Master and Apprentice, from a certain point of view, A New Hope. If Obi-Wan is facing Darth Vader, again, there has to be some damn good motivation for him to break his watch over young Luke Skywalker and risk exposure to the galaxy. Perhaps Qui-Gon calls to him from the Force because his spirit senses his conflict stirring in Anakin. Obi-Wan, feeling Anakin's presence because of their deep connection through the Force, sets off to potentially save what's left of his former apprentice. There is also a reckoning to be had between Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon. However, when we meet Obi-Wan in this story, I don't imagine he's going to be in the best of spirits. We've seen glimpses of his state in the first run of Marvel's Star Wars issues 7 and 15, I think. And well, we see he's not in a great place, disconnected from the Jedi, living in isolation, and with a singular purpose to watch over a child and hope one day they can undo the mistakes of their father. It's not too hard to consider Obi-Wan may have some angers, and the person who put them on the path was Qui-Gon. Qui-Gon's dying request fulfilled ultimately cost Obi-Wan and the galaxy so much. So I imagine the first conversation between Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon will not be a pleasant one. Perhaps a subplot of the show will be Obi-Wan learning to let go of his anger and disappointment in his former master. We need more Star Wars stories about healing and forgiveness. So Obi-Wan working through hatred would give a hopeful subtext to an inescapable failure if he attempts to redeem Anakin. We shall see. I hope we see little 10-year-old Luke in this series. There has been a lot of leaks that we will, but then again, I don't really follow leaks, so maybe there is already reliable information confirming this. I don't know. It's well established in A New Hope Luke knows Obi-Wan as Ben Kenobi, and it's not the first time they've ever met. If Luke is a large presence in this series, maybe it means the road to Vader is laid out for Obi-Wan in a completely different way. Perhaps Obi-Wan leaves Tatooine, afraid he's been discovered by the Empire, and wants to distract them from any possibility of finding Luke. I would be very surprised and disappointed if we don't see a live-action Clone Wars flashback featuring Obi-Wan and Anakin and Ahsoka. All the pieces are there. Rosario Dawson has already brought Ahsoka to life on screen, and it wouldn't be hard to fit this into a scene where Obi-Wan reflects on his days. We saw Ahsoka in live action in both The Mandalorian and The Book of Boba Fett. This doesn't have to be a happy flashback. I'm going to end this here now, so it saves me from going on a wild bantha chase of my own theories. What if we end up seeing this May? Obi-Wan Kenobi seems to have all the potential for some great storytelling. While I'm sure each fan will find things to enjoy and criticize, this is a welcome revisit of an appealing character for Star Wars fans like myself. There are so many great possibilities for Obi-Wan. Self-discovery, emotional healing, forgiveness, and punishment are on my top tier list. And I really hope Disney don't just throw Obi-Wan's character out the window now and destroy it somehow. Obi-Wan is a character who never lived for himself. And hopefully, maybe, if Disney are smart enough, this series will give us a look at that. History of the Jedi, the front lines of an endless war, and the duty to a now-dead republic. Perhaps the sands of Tatooine have been healing him, and we'll see an Obi-Wan Kenobi like no other. Hopefully. Whatever that is, I'm excited to see it, and will enjoy passing the time while considering the endless possibilities. This is All Things Podcast, Episode 11. My name is Isaac. If you have any theories, shoot us a message on any of our social medias, and we will see you next episode. Take it easy out there, everybody.